That's that. So, all the other sections of the issues, we've got community facilities and services to look at tonight, and intergovernmental coordination. And you've probably seen that email from me where I said all the stuff about the policies sorted to the issues. So, need I say more? Hi.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Fine.
Oh yes. I'll just get myself another piece in my office so that I can see that.
Sandra, has anybody talked to you about a garden at your community center? Since we had that meeting? No. So, Mark can contact you, Josh can contact you.
I don't remember seeing an email from them or anything.
Okay. What'll be the date when you come over to me?
Well, on Tuesday I'm going to do them over there all day, because that's when I have the center open for when we do feed and everything. Wednesday, yeah, I'll use a Thursday evening.
Thursday after 12?
Mm-hmm. All day Tuesday.
Tuesday tomorrow?
Yes.
I'm coming tomorrow.
Okay. You have address?
No.
Okay. All right, I suppose we might have some more people coming in as the work session wraps up. Or do you know that? Are they still having
their session? No, they're still going. Okay. Jason had three items. When I left, he was still on item number one.
Okay, but so we can probably go ahead and get started. For those of you just joining us, this is our fifth workshop, and we've been going through the issues and opportunities part of the plan, and that's divided up into 10 sections with different sections like economic development, education, community wellness, and so forth. So we've been through those, and tonight we're on the last couple sections of the issues and opportunities. It's been a long journey, but I'd say the plan is the better for it. And tonight we're looking at those community facilities and services issues and opportunities and intergovernmental coordination. And then we're going to talk briefly about community policies, but the issues and the opportunities are the hard work and the stuff that needs to be gone over in more detail. And so that's where we're at. Let's all take a look at this, at the issues under here, community facilities, and see what we want to change, what we want to add, what we want to delete. And some of the things you'll see listed here come out of prior workshops because things came up that fitted under the community facilities category.
Well, and just skimming down here, to number 8, library needs improvement and more support. Well, the library is going to move, right? So we need to say something about the library, but probably not this particular sentence. I just was jumping to that because that was easy one to skim.
Sure.
We maybe need more library hours or,
sure.
Something. I don't know what it is that the library will need once it moves. And it's not going to move for a little while,
Where is it moving to, do you know?
I do. It's moving to the old doctor's building on
Julia Drive?
Yeah. Which is sort of in the northish, north of where it's...
off Connell Road.
Yeah, off Connell, sort of by Blue Pool.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So,
okay, so library needs, what does it need? What do you all think?
Well, I'm sorry that I jumped all the way to number 8. Maybe we should
Fine. Yeah. Well, we'll keep thinking about that.
In my mind, the library needs to be accessible, and I don't know that on Julia Drive it's going to be accessible.
That was my first thought. Because right now it's in my neighborhood, so it's, I was sad.
It's accessible now. You can actually walk there. I don't know that you could walk to it on Connell.
Yeah.
Well, you could if you live right around there, but beyond that.
Right. But you could walk to where it is now from downtown Valdosta. You could walk up William Street. There's a walking sidewalk, except for the last block. You could walk to the drive to the library.
And so, that last block will be coming. It's just there's no money to do it at the time. But yeah, it was part of the plan. That was one of the reasons for...
Right, well, it's because it went to the library. Now the library's going to move away from the sidewalk that walks to it.
Whatever happened with the Five Points development?
Is that just shelf, no funding.
Wasn't the plan to put the library there and to do a new auditorium there, right?
Right.
So that would have taken care of 6 and 8.
Right. Well, even at out of Five Points, getting to the library, if it's out of it, would be hard for people. It, I mean, and we talked enormously about transportation. Theoretically, a transportation stop will always be at the library. Some stop on the transportation will be at the library.
Is there not a mobile library anymore service? Yeah, you used to have like a delivery truck with books that used to.
Oh yeah.
Bookmobile? I don't think
they
have bookmobile anymore.
I guess we don't have that.
Number 9. Says something about a need for a community center on the north side of town. Mm-hmm. It's sort of ambiguous, depending on what you define as the north side of town.
Which town?
Exactly.
Right, true, exactly.
Exactly. And you have Maxie Park, you have Freedom Park, and the hospital line.
I'm thinking maybe we should strike that one because it's so ambiguous, although if you all can think of any community center needs, just put them in.
Was on number 11.
This one's
number. Utility rate?
Utility rate.
Here in the city and the county is outrageous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a compared with other community, my gosh, I don't know. Looks like the highway route. So I think that utility rate need to be looking at. I don't know how we can do it, but looks like you know, said. I and my wife, two of us, living there, have to pay about $50 in the county.
Mm-hmm.
Just for two of us, it's outrageous. I don't know why I pay so much. Then in the office, you say I'm the only one person down there all the time, and it's only 8 hours a day, and I've been charged over $50 also in that office. I don't consume it. I only crush toilet about the most of all. I don't have a Brad program, but you see, I only crush about 4 times a day. Why pay $50? So utility just in this area, in this county and the city, you need to be looked at it.
Sure. So that's definitely still an issue. It's a good thing we have that. We have that with.
And the same thing, of course, I mean, Julia Power, I don't think we have power over Julia Power here, do we?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, actually, you see, I did them, I mean, authority to withhold from my checking account. Well, they took advantage of charging me as they wish, looks like it.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than strike number 9 completely, Aaron, I'm going to leave it. First part of it the same, be more recreational amenities such as friendly options and community centers in areas that are currently underserved.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I wasn't going to strike the whole issue. I was just going to delete that thing about a community center on the north side of town. But yeah, we could say community centers in areas?
Well, I'll leave the list, but it's recreational amenities such as, I think it's good to give those examples, not just, you know, public parks, but actually some other things. In other words, to demonstrate a mixture.
Sure.
But in areas that are currently underserved, sort of leaves it open for us to choose those areas or study those areas.
Yeah.
It also involves the entire county.
Right.
Not just, you know, a town or two.
Right, uh-huh.
And number six, I mean, that's very short and simple, but it ignores planning efforts that have already gone on. Mathis Auditorium needs improvement.
Mm-hmm.
And we can sort of leave that as is, but tack on language that planning efforts for a new municipal auditorium should continue.
Well, number seven needs to be reworded. Need a larger entertainment venue needs to be, planning efforts for a larger entertainment venue need to be continued.
Six and seven.
Probably combined.
Think of it combined.
Yes.
But that's it. I mean, we went through a 13-month planning process for a new municipal auditorium, down design, down to architectural concepts, site plans, everything. The funding source we had anticipated for that evaporated, and the whole project is sitting on a shelf,
waiting for
a pot of gold to come along.
Sure. So those two can be combined into one that just says planning efforts for a larger entertainment venue should be continued. We could even say venue with an S in parentheses.
Okay.
And with number four, that already includes what we have already working on. So when you say we need to improve our wastewater, stormwater, and sewer system, that is what we're already doing. So we need to see if that works.
It needs to say continued. And also, who is the we?
And we, it's inferred as Valdosta, but it doesn't say that. And we're just one of five cities.
It needs to say something like improvements to.
Right, something more passive voice.
To improvements to Valdosta's wastewater, stormwater, and sewer systems need to be monitored for effectiveness. Or something.
Continued.
You know, it's interesting, the idea that stormwater flows into sanitary sewers, it happens in cities that are over a certain age, because when they were originally designed, all that water just ran down to the river and it wasn't processed in any way. Then when the idea of wastewater treatment came, well, so then all of the stormwater goes in with the wastewater and gets treated all together. Now we have closed systems, so some of the rainwater goes in the...
Right, and it's not supposed to go into the sanitary sewer. What we have is the sewer pipes that leak, and we get inflow and infiltration.
Right.
Bad connections.
And so the whole processing of all water needs to... You know, because we still have problems on the south side. Water in the ditches that's, you know, not handled correctly. We've talked about that in other areas. But in terms of a facility, I don't know how that fits in, but stormwater handling is still something, and it's part of public services.
Well, 4 and 5 is similar. Just go together, too, because when you're going to be improving it or continuing to monitor it, we're going to make sure it's adequate. Would we make sure it's adequate and just continue to monitor that it's working? I mean, looking at 4 and 5, I'm thinking we're going to need to improve.
It would, in my mind, the monitoring of the water that goes into the river, the city does that on their own, but in my mind it would be brilliant if it was done by independent water, for all the places where water goes into the river. If the monitoring of the upstream and downstream flow was done by independent.
Such as like independent the different counties or the cities or?
By an outside, not affiliated with the government organization, not affiliated with the county or any of the cities. No, if Hayhire is monitoring their own water, where they're putting it in the river, what confidence do you have? The same thing about Valdosta, you know.
But who would pay for that?
We do have a couple of issues already under natural resources that may mean we're covered for this, from our prior workshops. We've got under natural resources, we've got poor drainage and stormwater issues up in the community. Yeah, and then we've got another one saying we need independent third-party water quality monitoring upstream and downstream of all wastewater problem areas.
Okay.
So I think we're probably...
Okay. So then this just needs to be, as you said, passive voice. Improvements to Valdosta's wastewater need to be monitored.
Mm-hmm.
With independent monitoring.
Okay,
number two.
Well, we've just been looking at all the community facilities and services issues, and we've been sort of jumping around, but we've been on that section. So.
Okay, good. You got to take our list in here.
Mm-hmm.
Several times in the last few minutes, I brought up the fact that they had said that the sewer was a problem, capacity was a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And they had like four things that they were thinking about doing. One of them was piping to the Little River.
Mm-hmm.
And every time recently that I brought it up, they said there is no problem.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just
mm-hmm.
curious about this.
And I've got that question in flag, Ariel, too, to talk with the higher officials about that, about
the
wording of this.
I was going to say,
my impression is that their sewer capacity issues from 10 years ago have been abated.
Sure. Okay.
Because of things that they've been doing several years ago.
Okay.
Well, if this sentence is a sentence from 10 years ago, that may be true. On the other hand, Tahara has built a lot of houses in the last 10 years. So, you know, even less than 10 years ago, maybe five
right.
years ago, they were at capacity. They were
Well, they were under
capacity.
Consent order, and they couldn't
yeah.
approve anything unless the state approved it. And they've gotten beyond that to the point that the state has let them go and approve their own. In other words, they didn't have enough capacity that the state didn't
and
have to approve
and
project
so
by project.
Do they have a wastewater treatment plant, or do they have land application? What are they doing up there?
They have a treatment plant.
And it goes to which creek?
Frank's Creek, I think, is the final discharge. It goes into a swamp and then to Frank's Creek.
Just last year, they were showing plans that piping to Little River was one of the choices.
Right. Well, they also
so I wonder where all the problems went, disappeared.
They also entered into agreement with Lyons County to share in their force main pumping from Creekside West down to Cent Creek. And the systems are connected, really as a backup. And how much of that actually they built in terms of the connection, I don't know, but that was several years ago. Again, part of my question for the Hayhower folks.
Right. Creekside West is in Hayhower proper.
It is not.
It's in the county.
It is in the county, and it is connected by sewer force main.
To the
North Lyon system that serves Stone Creek and Foxboro and River Chase and all those, River Chase, Grove Point. And so Hayhower has sort of built a connection into it as a sewer customer for the county. But there was enough capacity demonstrated in that line where Hayhower could tie in. This is back when they were still having some consent order issues
right.
and they needed, you know, some capacity quickly. That's one of the solutions they came up with. But I don't think they're utilizing that much, which tells me they've actually found a way to up the capacity of their treatment plant.
Well, or that's their plan B, and if they want to build more houses, they're just going to send this
right.
down there.
Well, I mean, they're still building houses there. They've got more, and they've got more projects coming.
Right.
Not huge ones, but more projects.
So ultimately, do you think that issue still stands?
Or? I think it's something that they've got ongoing issues. I know they have I&I problems there.
Mm-hmm.
So there needs to be some language in here for Hayhower. It's just a matter of how to word it.
Sure.
Okay, item number 10 needs to stay and be in boldface.
I hear you. For sure.
Access to broadband?
Yeah, oh my gosh.
We can put in needs desperately.
Desperately needs.
It takes hours to upload.
Uh-huh.
It's ridiculous how bad it is in our county. It's criminal. It's criminal.
It is. They're
very
stoked. You know, it's all private sector stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We could choose to have a public internet. We could force ourselves and do it.
We could.
So that's why he used to stay in here, because we could force ourselves.
How did the county get there, I think? Can't do it. So they have better coverage?
I know that there's fiber that runs along the railroad track, but nobody can afford to tap into it.
I thought one time y'all told me that if you went to the county building and sat there, you could.
No, I can't even get on their network anymore.
Oh, okay, so that's gone, okay.
They probably have a higher speed connection for their Wi-Fi.
Well, number 12, I agree too. I went to go recycling and I couldn't even put magazines in anymore, could only put cardboard. That was sort of horrifying.
Well, I'll say this about 12. In the city, that does not apply.
Right.
Because in the city, there's nothing to it. You load it up in a box, stick it out there and they get it.
We have curbside recycling.
Well, but.
So it's pretty much anything in your box, and they grab it.
Yeah.
Well, but the thing is, I used to be south and went to their recycling center. They said, the city is taking our recycling now. So the city is taking the recycling from deep south on Industrial Boulevard and we can't put magazines in anymore.
The city is taking theirs, meaning is that the facility, the deep south just can't accommodate what the city is.
No, deep south was having some haul, selling their recycling or giving their recycling to some hauler. Now the hauler of their recycling is the city of El Paso.
How did that happen?
I don't know, it just changed lately because the last time I went, September ago when I went, I could take all my paper, newspapers, magazines, and it was single stream. And now you have to separate the cardboard, goes in this one, no paper, no paper like this, no newspaper, no magazines, cardboard only, tin cans, plastic, that was all.
Which is odd because we have single stream in El Paso, you know, you just put everything.
Yeah, except, but they don't take magazines or styrofoam. If you put it in your bin, at least it's been my experience, you try that, they dump it in your garbage can.
Oh, I better stop putting it in my bins.
I didn't know that, I thought they took whatever you put in.
I unload my magazines, we don't have many.
Okay, so how do we need to be able to get rid of magazines, see, we're identifying a problem here, we need to be able to get rid of magazines.
And apparently it was such that there was no recycling market for magazines, so they just put it in the solid waste.
Because it takes more resources to break down that glossy paper, right?
I don't know, I'm sure it's market driven.
I was told that if you put stuff in the recycling, when it gets out to the dump, they put it all in the same place.
That's the rumor, it's the word on the street.
Yeah, the city's recycling goes to a hauler which takes it out of town to a processing facility that sorts. And we're under contract to do that, and it's for single stream, we used to have to sort it ourselves.
I'd rather sort it myself because I'd have some confidence that the tin cans were going to the tin can recycling place.
That's what I thought, the city was contracting theirs out, that's why I was wondering.
Yeah, they haul it off to Milledgeville, I think is where it goes, there's a MRF up there. And they had a transfer station they were going to build, this was a different contractor, but it was on West Savannah Avenue. It was gonna be a pre-sort location.
Yeah, that didn't happen, did it?
They didn't build, but they did something else. It was the same hauler that was picking up everything and hauling it to Milledgeville. And to make it easier on them, because I think they were gonna get some other local contracts. They wanted a gathering facility in El Paso to load it into semis to haul it to Milledgeville, it was more efficient that way.
Right, so they talked about the trucks would drive in, right?
Yeah, and this went through variance, I guess it was ZBA, went through the planning commission for rezoning. And then the conditional use.
There's a big challenge, a big MRF in Milledgeville, is that what they call it, a MRF?
Okay, so what's the sentence we need to say about recycling? The community does not provide sufficient recycling services, I'm sort of going with that now, sticking with that sentence.
I would strike community and put county.
Or portions of the community do not provide. So that points the finger at some of the six governments, just not all six.
Portions of.
Well, what's a recycling like in Hahara?
I don't really see that as I do myself.
I don't know if they have curbside or not, I tend to think they don't, but I don't know.
Okay, well, so I'm.
Portions of the.
Portions of, I'm good with that.
I've never seen recycling in Hahara, I've never seen bins out there passing through.
So so they rely on.
About these recycling things, really, if you have a good tax incentive, it should be a private enterprise, and the government should have nothing to do with the recycling.
In the county, they don't. They don't have anything to do with garbage either, garbage or recycling.
Right, that's what I'm saying. They have some kind of tax incentive or something, encourage them in the private sector to take care of it. You know, I don't think the tax money should somebody, if we have enough tax incentive, I think recycling business should be very profitable. If you own a third world country or any places beyond the United States of America, recycling is a big business. You know, where I'm coming from, the people, recycling company, you see, they are making money. They collect anything, you know. Bottles, you know, glass bottles or plastic or any metal. They separate different metals. They make money. So I think tax incentive is most important to encourage a private enterprise to do this recycling.
So
it could be an opportunity.
Maybe we have more trash because we're trash people when it comes to that.
Yeah.
Did you see those people in Philippines, you know, something like go to that church mountain, dig out of stuff, because it's a private enterprise to make money. And people can make money out of trash dump.
Well, if that was the case here, I mean, it seems like you'd have people lining up for the contract.
Yeah.
There must not be the same economics at play.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I just wondering about the tax incentive.
I had asked that about the city, because the city was having recycling lights. I mean, one point it was like they wasn't making money. So I haven't looked at it enough, but that's a very good question, a very good thought. I'm wondering that, because I understand you can make money from recycling.
Mm-hmm. The markets fluctuate depending on which commodity and so on. That's why some places will stockpile newspaper or cans or something until the price comes back up.
Yeah.
And the private sector folks, that's what they do, and they've got the warehouse or the yard space to do it.
Okay.
Well, we
it's
could
all market driven.
We could add all these ideas into the issue. I mean, we could state that like the service needs to be better facilitated and expanded with better incentives to provide service, with more materials accepted, because that's been a concern. And with more recycling locations, facilities, blah, 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 all the stuff that's already there. So that might be a way of stating the issue.
Maybe better communication too, because seriously, a lot of people will tell you they don't bother to sort it because they've been told that it all gets stuck
goes
in the
to
same
the
place.
Well, and we know that ADS was taking everything that they were recycling to the dump. And they had a separate truck came by, but it all went to the dump anyway. So they said, it's too contaminated, we don't even bother.
Okay.
What about that the master's auditorium, number 6? Can you be more precise what needs to be improved?
I think we and this may have been just before you came in, but we decided to state it as planning efforts for a larger entertainment venue should be continued. So that means number 6 and 7 just kind of get rolled together into a broader issue.
And I wouldn't use the word larger in that.
Oh, good.
More modern.
More.
That's the whole issue. The building's 56 years old.
It has
gone beyond its life cycle.
Should we say an improved entertainment center? Or more modern?
New.
Okay.
Well, the part of that whole 5 points development was going to be a new auditorium and a new library, right?
And other developments.
Well, then the old library just sold. What are they doing with the money that they sold that for?
What is the library doing? That's a good question.
Yeah, I mean, are they?
They're rebuilding.
They're investing it into the redesign of the building that they got in swap trade.
So the whole idea of the 5 points development is just out the window.
No, it's on the shelf. The city still owns the property. The plans are still there. The library does not have to be part of that development. In fact, if it isn't, it actually is a good thing because it frees up 3 acres that could be used for something else.
Mm-hmm.
When we went through that planning process, so the rest of you all know, is we had specific plans, program design for the municipal auditorium, and even down to a floor plan, I mean, everything. The library was not that far along in its planning process. Only thing they could tell us is they wanted 3 acres of land to put their building on. The design of the building, the components of the building, we did not know. We had an idea, so we had to block out a 3-acre site next to the auditorium in hopes that eventually, when the library got built, their design would fit into the city's design, mm-hmm. the auditorium, mm-hmm. but we didn't have that. The architects really wanted both, so they could design the two together, mm-hmm. but we didn't have that. And this is, you know, a few years ago.
Yeah.
So we had to proceed anyway, because we couldn't wait. So we just carved out 3 acres for them and said, all right, when you get ready, build here.
Well, yeah, it might be better that they do their own thing then.
Well, if they do, then all it does is free up those 3 acres, mm-hmm. you know, for something else, and there's a, you know, world of possibilities that could be done there. Even to the point that the city could adjust its site plan a little bit, mm-hmm. you know, to utilize that acreage.
Well,
I mean, there's room there, and some of you may not realize the entire Five Point Shopping Center does not belong to the city, just part of it. The area where Farmers Furniture and Bose and all that, so that long building, mm-hmm. that's still privately owned.
Okay.
All the way down to Oak Street. But Big Lots and the rest of it, that's city owned.
Isn't the library going to build up there where the old doctor's lab was?
Julia Drive.
We're late too. We already talked about that.
Yeah, Julia Drive, that's where they're going.
My lab.
But there's still a need. Panthers Auditorium is still getting older. Mm-hmm. It's still having maintenance issues and expenses.
So
it still needs, in the city's view, needs to be replaced
sure.
with a new auditorium, either on that yeah. spot or somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Long term, somewhere else makes more sense
sure.
because of the long term plans for that block with the hospital. Mm-hmm. You know, part of the issue with Mathis is, I mean, for 1960, it was a pretty nice facility, but in today's market with, you know, entertainment groups that come through town, they need something a little bigger and a lot better.
Sure, that needs
and takes up more room.
Sure.
Well, that's my question. When we have entertainment coming to town, usually how many people went to see those shows? You see, in Masters Auditorium, I have never seen Masters Auditorium ever feel
to you must not have been there during ballet nights.
Yeah.
It's
sometimes full.
Yes.
Yeah. My daughter went through the Girl Rock Dance Studio and did all their little yeah. ballet shows. Every show I went to, it was standing room only.
Because you have parents and relatives who come to those. But he's right about the other things that have come there.
You know, there were 80 of us that stand across the back. And it seats over 1,200. I mean, there's a lot of capacity there.
How does the entertainment stuff coordinate with like venues like the college or Wild Adventures?
There's a convention and tourism bureau. Of course, there's the conference center out on Norman Drive, which is part of what the new Mathis will coordinate with, not compete with, but actually coordinate events with. But yeah, I mean, the issue with the Valdosta Symphony or concerts at Wild Adventures, those are different types of entertainment. And so supposedly, I think this Convention and Visitors Bureau coordinates all of that. I would like to think
well,
so.
Well, I don't know. Turner Center for the Arts does the 4 shows a year that come
yeah.
into Mathis that are, you know, off-Broadway kind of stuff. But so many local groups use Mathis either for their ballet shows or their community events that multi-prism is
right.
busy all the time.
And that was part of the city's planning process, was to keep it as a municipal auditorium, the new building, but also affordable so the local groups could continue to use it. That was one of the mandates from the city to the designers.
Where does the Civic Center fit in?
It's a county facility. Not sure how well it works as an entertainment venue, other than, you know, trade show kind of stuff.
No, well, let me just
not really designed for performing arts.
Yes, she no. But it's being renovated, so I didn't know if it fit into the
well, it's being renovated so like the roof doesn't leak when the kids are having their archery shows, you know.
Yes.
They shoot bows and arrows in that building.
And when the fair comes to town, they have showers and all that. They
right.
have to bathe in the sinks.
for how many days a year must I already told them I didn't know, utilize?
Well, I don't know the answer to that.
We, I can't remember the numbers, but they made a listing of all the groups that use it on a regular basis.
Uh-huh.
And it was like a 2-page list. I mean, it was pretty long.
Pretty full?
Yeah. It's used a lot.
I thought that place was empty all the time.
No, Memphis.
No.
Oh, no, Memphis is a busy place.
It's busy. At least I would say at least twice.
Particularly this time of year.
A month or more.
I would say it's busy every weekend.
People have to book.
Very hard to get a weekend booking in there.
Yeah,
I mean, the event that I have there, I'm doing a weekday.
Yeah, just remember, it's in two halves. You've got an auditorium side,
right,
and you've got a multi-purpose room side.
Right.
Well, and some events use both of those, where they have dinner in the multi-purpose part before the show on the other side, so.
It seems like we may have covered the issues pretty well, unless there's
I wish that Jane was here. Lack of a shelter for homeless during cold weather.
Yeah.
Do we have, I mean, we open Mathis, people can sleep in Mathis if they need to sleep on a cold night. It's not great solution. It would be nice if there was a place where everybody that was homeless could actually go in regularly and know that they were safe, but you know, it's okay.
And part of the issue is also shelter where a homeless can get to it. I mean, one big shelter countywide isn't going to work. And I wonder if we should pluralize this, lack of shelters.
Well, shelter, it can be a plural word, lack of shelter in general.
Yeah, it could, can be.
Maybe shelter sites.
Yeah, shelter sites.
Shelter sites.
Yeah. And I don't know what the last one means. Agricultural resources are needed for agricultural recreational activities, but I agree with that sentence.
And I'm not sure what it means.
I don't know what it means, but I agree with it.
No, the question came, it's a good place to go. Why we need to establish something to compete with Gresham Camp?
Agritourism stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I told school bus. Went over there all the time and all different schools have a student. He's a racing can.
All right, but that's one place, and that's
I don't know.
Agricultural resources. I mean, I can think of other resources that might be needed for agricultural recreational activities.
We could just say resources. Just resources.
I don't think we're short on agricultural resources, folks. I wonder if we shouldn't just repoint that to words along the line that agritourism.
Sure.
We have that in another section already.
Yeah, in economic development.
Economic development?
Yeah.
Okay.
We have, let's see what it says exactly. I know there's at least one issue that puts in a good plug for agritourism.
So we talked about the trails, 4137, right?
Yeah. I'm trying to find it. I know it's in here, though.
Well, and in terms of community facilities and services, here's a facility that I would love to have here for our local farmers, and it's in terms of economic development, maybe. But I would love to have a local meat processing plant, and I would like to have it on the county extension property. So that...
It's open to the public?
Yes, but that there would be a USDA certified processing person there so that you could come and have your meat. You wouldn't have to carry it all the way till, I don't know where the most local US, Fort Valley. Okay, I do know. I can take my animal to Fort Valley and have it processed there. That's a long way to carry my animal. Or I can take it to an auction in Thomasville and I can auction it and just get the money for a live animal and they carry it somewhere else. It would be nice if in Lowndes County we had a processing facility so that people who are raising sheep and goats and cows could have them processed here. I would love to see that for our local people. And you know, people, every county adjacent to us would come and use it, I guarantee it.
So this could be a new issue. Need a local meat processing plant with USDA certified personnel on site?
Wait
a moment. Government operating facilities?
You in order to sell meat, it must be USDA certified. I would love to have it USDA certified.
I know, so that's going to cost me a taxpayer's money again.
Well, no, but see, we might. We might be able to get USDA grant money to do that, to support local farmers, and if local farmers could carry their meat here, their animals here to have them processed, they could sell. That would be good economic engine.
A USDA grant.
No, you don't. You're not going to finish your animal there. You're going to come, you're going to bring your animals, and you're going to have them processed.
Got the facilities.
There is a, you could, right at the fairgrounds there. They have plenty of pen space in that barn. There's a barn right there.
But it's very regulated too. Like you can't. You have to make sure the animals don't get scared before they get to the killing.
I've been to Fort Valley. I've been in that processing plant.
They spend a lot of money making sure that doesn't happen.
I've been to Fort Valley. I've been to the processing plant. I would love to have one here.
Do you think there's enough people around here to justify that expense?
Well, and the thing is, here's the expense part. If we have it in our comprehensive plan, then when money might be available from USDA, we could apply for those kinds of grant monies that are tax money that's out there that somebody's going to get. Might as well be us. If we don't have it in our plan, we can't apply for those things.
And remember, the language she's suggesting is just on the issues and opportunities page where we identify a need and simply state it there. Later on, when we get into action statements, it would be language like explore the possibility of, or work with USDA to, you know, create or something like that. Mm-hmm. So it's not binding local governments to spend money at this point.
Right.
It's just to explore the need. And I agree, I don't think, you know, it should be solely funded by local governments.
No,
I think USDA becomes the major, if not the only player in that.
Right. Well, I've talked to USDA personnel about this a couple of times.
Okay.
And they are friendly towards it.
They agree with the notion that it's
they agree that it could fill a need. Yeah. Doesn't have to be 365 days of a year. It could be you can sign up and you know, on Wednesdays we do cows, and on Saturdays we do hogs, you know, whatever.
Do they do deer processing?
We can ask.
What the USDA rules are is the animal has to be killed on site, I'm pretty sure. So unless you bring a live deer, probably not.
But there are locals who do deer processing.
There's plenty of places where you can have your meat processed locally, but you can't sell it then. So if you wanted to have a small herd of cattle, and you want to have them be really beautiful, and you have to carry them far, and it's stress on the animal to carry them far.
Plus expense.
Have you ever
meat's
tried,
not good if you stress them.
Have you ever visited that Mr. and Mrs. Carroll, you know, family?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever visited them? They can do that for you.
Yeah, I was wondering what happened to that.
I mean, on the Madison Highway.
Something.
Called Sunset Farm. I mean, Sunset.
And do they process?
Yes, they do.
I don't think they will process and give it back to you, though.
Yeah.
Yes,
but can somebody bring their cow have it USDA stamped?
Yes, I think they have USDA people there.
Take it home with them in their cooler.
Why don't you ask it? I don't know. I have never
something.
Explore.
Yeah.
Are you looking for development of agricultural recreational activities and economic opportunities?
Well, that's not recreational. I'm looking for a way to support our farmers who are raising small herds. That's what I'm looking for.
Yeah, but like I said, even USDA, that's still our tax money. You see that? We have to pay IRS to hire USDA, so no matter what.
The money's out there. We might as well try to get it back.
No. I think I already have paid taxes. I'm sick and tired of it. So don't ask any government to do anything anymore.
Private
enterprise can do it.
Otherwise, somebody else is going to get
do it.
We should probably look at the.
You know, even I think the Brandon.
Have you ever heard of, what is it, gender processing out in Lakeland? Lowndes County, I think that's, it's still in Lowndes, Lakeland. Gender processing, where you process meat, you can take your meat.
But you can't sell it. There's a ton of places that will process your meat.
For you and give it back to you.
And they'll give it back to you, and it'll be stamped, do not sell.
Okay.
Right.
I want stamped USDA grade A.
Okay.
And you wanna sell it?
We didn't sell it.
And then I'm gonna sell it, that's correct.
Do you, with these meat processing places, do you have to pay them to process it for you?
Yeah.
Oh, you do?
Oh, yeah.
Pay by the pound.
Yeah.
Just like if you take the cons, you know.
It's like getting your cons sold.
Yeah.
Get on, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cracked. And then give it back to you, or open up and back is the nuts.
I don't think your EPA is gonna let you do that, because they're trying to get it where just certain people can do that.
Don't say no, and if you don't ask, you can't get anything.
We're just gonna look into it. We think it might be a need here.
Let's make sure we look at the opportunities.
Because time is going by.
Because time is running up, yep.
Here we go, let's look ahead, and. Seven, number seven on the opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
It says there's an opportunity to improve local health and safety through improvements to the WWTP. Wastewater treatment plant.
Yeah.
Something that wasn't in the issues is education about health and safety risks, especially among adolescents.
Oh, right. And that would go in the community wellness section.
Yeah.
Is
that already in there?
Or? Probably not. So that's a good point.
That is an issue, not just here, but all over the country. I mean, you're looking at it like the case of Austin, Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
If anyone's not aware of that, they had an HIV outbreak there through meal sharing. That can happen anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Lead in your water can happen anywhere, too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to point that out. I mean,
good.
Yeah. Let's go on down the list. First one I think is good, the good bullet there. The second one, rainwater center. What is that there for?
Yeah, we'll make that a whole
It could give you a whole sentence. The rainwater center provides facilities, it's an opportunity for, provides opportunities for conferences, conventions.
Regional and statewide conferences.
Which it does.
Right. That's, we're just stating what our opportunities are. Rainwater Center provides resources, good resources for our community.
Yeah.
So we're looking to expand the type of activities that they're doing there, like conferences, the other larger conferences, or something else? I mean, when you say that we already have it still, so we're trying to look to, is an opportunity to do better or different, different hotels have their conferences, or other big cities have conferences, or even like, you know, we go out on a conference or something like that. Is it trying to look to expand and do more than what they're doing?
Well, is there going to be a new hotel and convention center downtown?
It is.
So it might be timely to reframe that opportunity as saying, there's the opportunity for this region to become a hub that hosts a lot of conferences and conventions, because we have two places.
Right. Well, and we're not hosting giant conferences. We're hosting those smaller, more intimate setting conferences. You know, we're not having thousands of people like go to Las Vegas. We're having, you know, certain size.
That's what I was saying.
Yeah, we can't do thousands, but we do hundreds.
Hundreds.
Okay. I mean, about several hundred.
We could say something like, the new conference center will expand the community's capacity to host regional and statewide conferences, conventions, etc.
The new conference center?
That's
downtown?
With the
hotel?
Yeah.
No, that's
not
so much.
Their conference facility is.
Oh, okay. Never mind then.
No, and there's other things downtown that are much
Well, bigger. Rainwater Conference Center offers those opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, you know, it can
potentially hold on. On those big hotels they just built, they have they have their own conference room, something like that. Then across the street, they have, you know, some 101 part of the street, they have a deducting facilities.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, not a big one, but I would suggest to say how a Chamber of Commerce coordinate or available conference site.
Maybe something like so existing and proposed conference facilities offer the opportunity to become a regional hub.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. For hosting conferences or something like that.
That's good.
So we tie all the conferences
together.
And point out the fact that we're getting more and more of them, and then together we can become, if there's coordination. And so those kinds of things we put in the statement parts of this.
What are we going to do about traffic?
Well, I mean, these are facilities all around.
Well, whole transportation section.
Yeah, that's all.
We did that last time.
I'm moving from Atlanta because I don't think you should sit through more than one set of lights.
Well,
and it's getting at some places here where I sit through 3 in the morning.
Still better than Atlanta. And you don't have to worry about that in Hayhara.
You do when you come from Hayhara.
What does it mean to say educate the public of need for utilities land acquisitions? And what utilities are acquiring land?
That's not the thing about the oil pipeline over here.
It might be a reference to Sable Trail, but where did this come from? Is this
This is all from the fire plan and from the Common Community Vision.
Common Community Vision, yeah, but that was a new topic for discussion when Common Community Vision was coming along.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably where that came from. Personally, I think we should strike it.
Everyone else okay with that?
I'm good with that because I don't think that utilities land acquisition is a good thing anyway.
It's not something I think that belongs in the conference plan. Yeah. I think it.
Is there any anticipated, other than that pipeline, is there any other major roadway projects or anything coming through next 10-year cycle?
Isn't the whole multimodal thing, are people still talking about?
Well, there's always road improvements and new roads, but this little statement deals with utilities.
What about broadband stuff? They're not doing anything with that broadband utilities. You know, they're not thinking about putting any more kind of wires or those little pipes that they use.
That doesn't usually need land acquisition because fiber optic cable will go in existing rights of way.
Right.
It doesn't take up as much space, you know.
Well, besides which wireless technologies are, perfectly acceptable
right.
in certain cases.
Well, part of a roadway expansion also involves utility acquisition.
Right.
That's why I was asking if there's any major projects coming along.
And a lot of that can be addressed in the transportation section. There's a few road projects out there that have been on the list for a long time that need to be coordinated with utilities expansions. And that may be something to put in here. Is coordinate expansions of utility systems with expansions of roadway systems.
Especially in the county where we forgot that we would have to move the utilities, so now we have to let a no bid contract for utilities moving by the way. So yes, it would be lovely if they would think about all of those things all at once.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
They should anyway. Sometimes it gets missed.
Items number 3 and 5 seem to be somewhat related, maybe. Mm-hmm. Education regarding utility cost rates and how to conserve energy and save money, and alternative energy, solar, as supplement and incentives.
We can combine those, and then the
opportunity, I think, is that South Georgia, Miles County, is has available infrastructure for electrical grid access and abundant sunshine for solar energy generation. So we have an opportunity to generate electricity with solar energy, like we do at the wastewater treatment plant, or you know, I would envision that if we could put solar panels on the conference center, everybody driving down 75 would go, hey, there's a forward-looking place, look, they're generating electricity for that building on the building. Because it is sunny here an awful lot of us.
And they've got the barn-shaped roofs to do it.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. So, you know, because we do have transmission lines, and all you got to do is be sort of close to one of those, and we could be positioned to generate more alternative energies.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how you want to say that sentence.
I would sort of like promote more alternative energy sources.
Well, because we have sunshine, our opportunity is that we have a lot of sunshine, many sunny days.
We can just say we have abundant sunshine for solar energy generation and ample infrastructure for grid access, which provides an opportunity to increase use of alternative energy.
That sounds good.
Sounds good.
What about the school system?
They have roofs. The palace has a roof. You know, there could be solar energy on the palace.
Well, some are doing it. It's just it's harder to retrofit the older facilities. I mean, we need industry coming to the county, and they have specifically asked us about doing solar panels on their rooftop.
Mm-hmm.
They were worried that we might somehow prohibit that, and I said absolutely not. Which I was encouraged that a major industry would even think along those lines.
Well, the DuPont.
Didn't.
Well, I went actually out to the DuPont building and looked all around with them and hooked them up with somebody, and then they never did go forward with theirs. You know, they have ginormous roof out there.
Well, yeah, I know a lot of them do. Look at Lowe's Distribution Center. That's 28 acres under roof.
That'd make a lot of electricity.
It would. I mean, the problem with those buildings, and sort of y'all come in, the engineers, is you've got to hold the weight up there. And sometimes those roofs might not have been designed to do that.
Are they a steel building? Then they're designed to hold the weight.
No, the pre-manufactured steel buildings, they're shaving every single ounce they can off of that building weight to save some cost.
Yeah.
So those things are designed exactly for whatever load they were initially designed for. The older ones, maybe. You know, there may be a chance because they built them more robust back then, but you know, they're wood frame.
This is one built in the mid-90s, probably more worried about wind load than anything else across the room.
And when you put solar panels up, you're basically putting a giant airplane.
I don't know why building hasn't fallen down yet.
We get enough wind here for wind power?
No.
No.
It's more of a it's not consistent through the year.
Yeah.
Parts of the year we get as much wind as most people, but not in the summertime.
Yeah.
When we get the frontal systems coming through, it's breezy here and it's enough. But
not a consistent flow.
Let's see, are we ready to move on to our last section? I feel like we should break out a bottle of champagne after this.
Yeah, at the end of the reading, let's.
Yeah. All right, intergovernmental coordination.
Well, I might reword number two. Engaging stakeholders is not always easy. I don't think it's a matter of being ineffective. I think that it's hard to get people interested in what's happening in the community.
Mm-hmm.
They're sort of they're in their lane, and they're not even nitty. They're just overwhelmed. You know, taking your kid to music lessons or dance lessons, and on the treadmill of work, and you can probably fit in one thing. It's hard to engage people.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very necessary So I think it's an issue because people don't engage.
Well, that's a good thing that you're developing this, because you can find goals where everybody will have engagement. You know, if there is an economic goal, if there's, hey, you know, you can earn an extra $20 a week, you know, put that solar panel up. Hey, you know, you just got the cost, you know. Or hey, you know, we'll have Google Fiber coming here if we can do this, this, and this. Well, yeah, that.
And education becomes a big part of that, that, you know, getting the word out to people. Strike out small communities. Need improved access to agendas and minutes everywhere, in every single government.
So instead of small communities, put in local governments.
Well, I think that the newspaper sort of pointed that out about the hospital authority, right?
Put local governments and authorities.
Authority. Yeah.
Sounds good. I wrote down organizations, but yeah, authorities. Pretty much everything.
With something we've been complaining about, and I saw this when I first came back about Austin. When you go into a meeting and you're sitting out there in the audience, and they're there talking about the packets before you, you're going, what? What packets? What are they looking at? And see, even when we get them to give us agendas, there's always stuff missing.
Yeah, it could be. Agendas, minutes, and packets.
Yes.
And
the mysterious packets.
The mysterious packet.
One thing about disposing the packets, and I've looked at it and looking at it on both sides of it, it's information. It's a lot of information. I know when I get one, I have to ask a lot of questions. And we give it to the public to start asking all those questions when it's, for them to really understand all that in the packet. I think you're confusing a whole lot more. Maybe we can get a condensed one different from what we get. Because I see some of those questions I got, and I get them now. I mean, with the package, some of the questions we get, it's a lot we have to ask. So I have to, for the public to get all, to get a package.
But here's the thing. The state law says that any individual that wants that packet gets it. Anybody that wants it gets it.
Well, they can ask for it. I'm just saying.
Well, okay. Well, here's the thing: having to ask for it is cumbersome. There should be a way that people who want it can easily access it. I'm not saying that you have to send it to every single person. Everybody in the world, but it needs to be somewhere where people who want it need to get it without having to pay extra. It really irks me that I'm forking over $65 sometime for something. $65 I paid for Open Records from a packet, which is available electronically, and I had to get it on paper. That yanks my chain.
They wouldn't offer it to you electronically?
No.
Well, maybe they should do something like that. Like, you know, we can leave. There's a website we go for our maps, any kind of maps you want, the Valor.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we should have something like that, and those who want it can go there and get it.
Well, that's all we're asking for.
Okay,
not everybody's going to go and get it.
Right.
Just if you put it on a website and you say, this is the packet for the meeting that's coming up next week, people who are interested can come get it, and the people that aren't interested, they're not going to come get it. They're not going to ask any questions.
That's what I was thinking.
And I assume those packets are updated right up to the meeting?
Sometimes get one. They will update them if something come up.
Right. So the electronic version method is great. I guess you don't have Wi-Fi access at those meetings.
Part of it is file size too. I mean, at least with Valdosta City Council packets, they go 40 megabytes sometimes.
Wow. It's a lot of pages. It's a lot.
It depends on the agenda.
There'll be things
anywhere
like
from 2 to 8 megabytes.
They'll be there. They'll never announce what the bids were.
Okay.
They'll just say it's in the package before you. The public has the right to know what those bids were.
Okay. Well, I mean, if they can put a site or something like that, it's just you. I just look at some of the questions I know we would be bombarded with that you would never get them answered, and it would be. I mean, some people just you would have to give them a class in what it is about what they're asking. But I understand what you're saying. Like, we got the map. There should be a spot maybe
Well, for all the rezoning cases that you hear,
okay.
You know, and all of those things aren't typed. I've been to the county commission where, and actually the last open records I got from them was electronic, the very most recent one. But I've been there time after time with pages that are not typed on a typewriter, which they refuse to give me an electronic format, even though my open records request said explicitly the electronic copy of rezoning number blah blah blah, and I got it printed out on a piece of paper. This has been an ongoing problem with the county, and so we'd like to solve this. Obviously, Barbara's had it with this problem with Tahara. We'd like this problem solved.
Well, it's not. I mean, it's no one. It's the whole. Like I said, Valdosta, all of them. Valdosta really was the first one that I noticed. I'm like, oh, wait, what? What are they talking about? They don't even tell you what the bid is, and you're supposed to come and be interested in what's going on.
I'm not
going
to agree with you on that.
Yeah.
Well, one, then the easy solution is just to post the meeting packets online, but you have to put a date there with them, saying which version you're looking at. With our government, I mean, the packets for the council meeting on a Thursday will go out a week earlier, and then sometimes it gets revised over the weekend because something got left out by accident. Or after the work session on Tuesday night, council wants more information, so then things get revised Wednesday. And that's the day before the meeting. So you have to have a way to note that.
Well, and for a person who's asking for the packet, so they don't maybe know all those revisions are even happening, and they're thinking that the packet that they have in their hand on paper is it. And they don't know. It would be so much easier if they were available online, and you could see packet version number, this date, that date, something. It would be just way easier for everybody.
More environmentally friendly, too.
Yes.
Well, that's something that could be done. I mean, as a staff member, I get the electronic version of the agenda packets.
Right.
And I archive them. I'm one of the few departments that actually does that, but I just like to be able to go back to them and look up something without having to bother the city clerk's office. And some of these files, I was a huge. Well, we can't even get them by email. We have to go to a link and download. It can be done.
You can give that link, though. That can be posted.
Well, I mean, it can be posted on the city's website and downloaded, or at least, the past year's worth can be posted there. And if you want older ones, then you go through the city clerk's office and get them that way. That way it doesn't fill up the website. Mm-hmm. But the counter side is some people are going to download them and wonder why it's taking so long to download. It's because it's 60 megabytes going through a dial-up connection or something.
Well, that pops up in your web browser. It says downloading one of 60 megabytes.
Yeah.
So you can see
how
many.
So you're waiting, and then you can wake up in the morning, and it's there.
And
actually, download isn't so bad.
And you can count, and you can also list the file size on the website, too.
Well, I look at they could probably put a link in the, really, on our web page that we have. They could put a link in there for that. And if anybody's interested, just like with everything else that we have on there, if they're interested, go in and look at them.
Yeah, you're not going to have a million people asking for this.
Right.
You're not even going to have 100 people.
Right.
You know.
Oh, and for me, if someone asks me for a copy of something, I'm not trying to just email it.
Mm-hmm.
Just be done.
And we appreciate that, young man.
Yeah, you're sometimes one of our frequent customers.
Pretty
much.
It's a lot easier for everybody just to do it that way than rather go through open records request and 3-day wait and everything else. If it's something simple.
I understand, you can't.
If it's complicated, then it needs to go through that process. But if it's simple, like an agenda list, copy of the minutes from 2 months ago.
Okay, thank you.
Issue number one and opportunity number eight talk about collaboration between community entities and governments.
Mm-hmm.
The two kind of seem oxymoronic.
Yeah, they conflict. We can't have both.
I just wanted to bring that up.
Thank
you. I don't know if you want to take a stab at that or not.
This number eight, if you put after the end of the sentence, when Moody Air Force Base is involved or at risk, then that sentence would be always true. If we need to defend Moody in any way, everybody comes together and works nicely. All the rest of the time, number one. Well, isn't that true, Matt, though? If there's something about Moody, you know, the base's mission or protecting the base,
yeah,
everybody's on board.
It gets the attention of the entire community.
But at, you know, what we were talking about the other day after zoning, you know, there just isn't coordination and collaboration between the county and the city of Boston.
The opportunity, the second opportunity, there was a good comprehensive plan and a better implementation of it should be a priority.
Mm-hmm.
That seems like an awkward thing to put in the comprehensive
yes.
plan.
Yes. Maybe we should just let the comprehensive plan speak for itself.
Okay.
Well,
I've pretty much found that it's in the comprehensive plan, it will happen.
That's awesome. So we were trying to put stuff in the comprehensive plan.
Good. We put a lot of good stuff.
Well, the thought there is, if you want stuff to happen, put it in the comprehensive plan.
But if you don't want it to happen, it's in.
Well, if you
it
don't, it just.
Well, it can't happen if it's not in the plan, basically.
Well, it can. It just depends on funding sources and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
If the, you know, the state gets involved, they look at the comprehensive plan, and if you've not identified it as a need or a priority or something like that, then they assume it must not be that big a deal, therefore they might not approve your grant application.
Next, the last opportunity, make projects that are focused on multiple entities a top priority. Aren't a lot of projects in here multiple entities? That's more implied throughout this entire document.
I
shouldn't
know
be
that
directly
that
stated.
Seems kind of vague,
yeah.
that opportunity. Do you think we should like that one?
Is that meaning like, I don't know, somebody builds an office complex, well, they're just looking at their office complex, they're not looking at the interconnectivity or multimodal.
Because you have to plan multiple approval processes to make that building happen.
Right.
I don't know the story behind those two buildings that are mentioned as examples, so.
And the examples aren't good either. Because
yeah. State, I mean, VFC is a state.
Some of the things that we've got to filter out of this is private sector related. You know, it doesn't need to be in the public document.
Mm-hmm. Southport's a classic. It's like a community thing. It doesn't have to do with government. I mean, it's just that Kimberly Golf Club.
It's a local event.
What is Southport?
It's a golf tournament.
Yeah, they canceled.
Really?
Yeah,
we
should
talk
to the guy who's been in Athens for the past 4.5 years.
Well,
and
I mean,
just getting back in the swing of things.
Some of this language is a little bit dated.
Yeah, they don't have it. Can we go to opportunity number one?
Mm-hmm.
The continuation of the Greater Lowndes Growth Advisory Committee? What the heck is that?
Oh, is that something obsolete too from the last plan?
It's something that has withered away. It was the Planning Commission expanded to include stakeholders from all around the community that came together in 2006,
mm-hmm.
which was the last time we did the comprehensive plan overhaul. And the decision was made then, and Jason, correct me if I'm wrong, as I was the private sector then, that group would continue on rather than being just the planning advisory committee for the comp plan. They would continue to be a planning advisory committee afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
And for the first few years afterwards, they met regularly, and then it got less and less frequent. And it's been a few years now since they've met at all.
Budget cuts and staff cuts.
Yeah.
Who was on that?
We invited all the major institutions and nonprofits from around the community. We would get together once every quarter to talk about the various future plans of the different institutions.
Stakeholder list.
So we'd have the city schools present, or the county schools present, or, you know, Bob Adventures present, and it would just be a clearinghouse for information. Yes, DSU
Hospital.
It was helpful, but we lost funding, we lost staff.
We used to be able to provide lunch or something like that, mm-hmm. just as part of a quarterly meeting. But
it really was for the benefit was communication. You had a clearinghouse for different major institutions in the community to communicate about what they were doing.
And did they actually share?
Mm-hmm.
They did. It was a good thing when it worked, while it lasted.
The closest thing we have now is what they've started at the local government level, where they pull in all the local governments to one meeting and have kind of a joint government meeting.
Yeah.
But then you're missing the private sector and the kind of institutional sector.
Well, so is that an issue that we don't have that anymore? That there's that's gone away? Mm-hmm. Should we put that as an issue that
it doesn't necessarily have to be them, but I think it's, you know, we're definitely missing out by having like a central communication point for all that.
Chamber of Commerce can't help
they
were
can't.
Part of it. They were one of the members. I mean, you could identify it as an issue that committee no longer meets mm-hmm. or has not met recently.
The chamber's probably been the one that's picked up the most when they were absent. The chamber probably picks up the most of that communication, but they don't fill all of it.
And part of the opportunity is to repeat what we did 10 years ago, take the stakeholder list for this and roll that into another committee mm-hmm. or an ongoing committee.
Mm-hmm.
And for purposes of, and I would state that in here, for purposes of communication mm-hmm. amongst public and private sector entities.
Sure.
Because, 10 years ago, the task of the greater committee, the stakeholders, was to put the conference plan together.
Sure.
Which is what we're doing now.
Okay.
But the committee afterwards, the work was done, but they decided to make it more of a communication form.
Mm-hmm. Could you maybe say again, how to word the opportunity? I have two different things written down.
If you want to put it in both issues and opportunities, the issues
right.
could be a statement that the Greater Lowndes Growth Advisory Committee has not met recently.
Uh-huh.
You could embellish that if you wanted to, but the opportunity is stakeholder group for this comprehensive plan update can reignite the Greater Lowndes Growth Advisory Committee
mm-hmm.
for ongoing communication between public and private entities.
Could we
ask
the word growth, though?
Yeah,
growth advisory committee?
Yeah, I don't think the word growth is the right word.
Before the chamber, I think it was VSU, they called it the Partnership for Metropolitan Development, is what it was called before.
Okay.
It was the growth
before 06. Okay.
Most of that communication takes place at the closest thing we have are these very large chamber events that they'll put out the community, what's their one where they do the demographic information?
And we do the economic summit each year.
That probably is the closest thing we have where it pulls together all the stakeholders and talks about here's information, here's plans.
And that's sort of taken over, I guess, for this. It's largely the same mix of people. It's an annual event and there's a lot of communication that goes on at those.
I care less about the name, more about the communication was helpful. Show up once a quarter and learn about a major institution's direction now. So.
Yeah, I think that would be very helpful. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, late y'all.
That was
planning commission.
Yeah, so the second and third items took a long time too, huh?
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, jumping back up to issues. Need more community involvement and better communication for community involvement. So that we all know that we need more community involvement. But when we talk about that, and number two, engaging stakeholders is not always easy.
Combine those two.
Maybe say engaging stakeholders is not always easy and we need more community involvement and participation.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if this is a possible opportunity, but the MPO is doing some work on their participation plan, and I wonder if that would be too specific to the MPO or
And Aaron, you weren't here when we went through the last time. There used to be a participation plan element that was required as part of this.
Oh, okay.
And that's one of the things the state chopped
off
of the planning standards.
Okay.
We still have our old participation plan.
Oh, okay.
So could we have an opportunity to reconstitute the participation plan or
I just think, to me, no one spends more time and probably more money on reaching out to the community than the MPO does. I think, you know, size of staff versus how much money they spend, they really, really try to reach out and engage the community. So community opportunity is, you know, how to help support them or learn from them in other areas.
They have a federal mandate to do it, too.
Yeah, they do. But, I mean, I don't think anyone works as hard about engaging community as the NPO does.
They meet in this building. Their office is in this building.
They meet in this room.
The county just made appointments to the Citizens Advisory Board. Three people.
Yeah, they have three committees and they make quarterly.
Are we getting near the end?
No.
We can certainly continue talking about intergovernmental coordination. But if we're ready to wrap up, I can talk a little bit about policies. What do you think?
Should we talk policies? Well, if you can give us some words of wisdom in the general sense about them.
Yeah. Sure.
It's in itself a pretty substantial document.
Yes,
it's also
it is.
A very important part.
Right. So what I did, this is what I do with all comp plans in our region. This is the way we've been operating since long before I came here. Take the issues that came out of all the workshops and associate policies with them. And the policies come from two places. They come mostly from the old comprehensive plan. And where I failed to find something fitting to an issue in the old comprehensive plan, I looked in the common community vision and found something there that fit. I did that for these two sections we reviewed tonight, so obviously that's going to change a bit. I'm going to have to do it over a bunch for community facilities and intergovernmental coordination. But the other sections are ready to look at, basically. I don't think there's going to be any changes, except I guess we identified one additional community wellness issue tonight, more education about health and safety risks, especially for youth and adolescents. But the plan has been to give you all the policies to review as homework, essentially. And so there's the handout, but the handout you have has also been emailed out to the big stakeholder list, the 370 people. And then as soon as I get this put in, updated from my notes from tonight, I'll send out a new version to everyone. But basically, those last two sections are the only things that will have changed. And so we've been thinking the policies, stakeholders can review the policies on their own, and we can have one last workshop just to review land use maps. But we could also have a workshop in a couple of weeks to look at policies, too. So what do you all think? You think?
Well, I think they need to be separate. We can't do both together, certainly. They're big, both.
Oh, right. Yeah,
topics.
Of course. Okay.
But I've got a question for you in terms of the formatting. Is this a sort of leading into a draft of what's going to be the policies part of it?
Oh, yeah.
Are we going to have goal statements too, or refresh my memory, has that been changed by DCA?
Do you mean that?
We used to have goal statements, and then under each goal statement would be a series of policies.
The way we have it now, well, the policies are organized under those 10 categories that the goals are under too. Like, you see the first section is economic development, and we have our economic development goal. So I can just put the goals there at the top of each section. There is a goals section in our workbook. That was the beginning of the whole thing where we goals.
Just didn't, all right, so it's not being filed here. Because I know later, maybe this is part of what this is, that you've got to pigeonhole each of the identified issues with things and goal statements and policy statements that you're going to do to address the issue.
Yeah.
It used to be you had to provide a separate matrix as part of the DCA review.
Right. Oh, and now I'm realizing I didn't set the policies out. This was not the government trying to cover things up. I just didn't put them there.
There was a copy, so she emailed out to us.
Right, right. So anyway, yes. So those are the policies as they currently stand. But this was emailed out to you. What, like maybe a week ago?
Early, like mid.
Tuesday, Wednesday, or so. Uh-huh. Yeah. And hopefully you all are on the email list. If not, if anyone signed up new, I'll make sure you get added to the email list. Thank you, Jason. Anyway,
so do these policies directly correlate with all the issues that
they do, yeah. Yeah, that's right.
But as we've gone through some of the language,
these are the issues that we've already identified. And
right.
Okay.
Exactly,
and
yeah. Yeah.
Which have existing policies.
Right. And like I said, all the policies are from those two existing planning documents. I didn't write anything new. They're all from the old comprehensive plan.
Do we need to consider different language, or,
mm-hmm.
I mean, do we think that what we wrote last time was good enough?
I think it's up to you all.
We need to review them like we've been reviewing the issues and opportunities, where language can be changed or
right.
merged together, or items deleted.
Except we don't have the resources to review them in as much detail in as many workshops, because we're going to run out of time.
Exactly.
And plus they already came in sentences that were in the correct grammar, so
sure.
we weren't struggling with
yes.
right.
phrases or things we didn't know about because they came from the common.
They were already from adopted
they
documents.
They were already from completed documents.
Yeah, which makes it a lot easier.
So, would you say that anybody that's interested in giving feedback on these policies should make sure they have an electronic copy and then email you back comments like
yeah.
on section 1.13, blah blah. Something.
That would be
and
great. That,
and if you would send that to all 370 people to say, okay, we're up to policies, and don't forget you can always email your comments in.
Right.
Get more than 10 people showing up.
That'd be
we
great.
Could all bombard Ariel with comments and suggestions and,
right.
and sort them out.
Yeah. People can email in their changes and people can call me too, you know, if you're into that, you know. You can also send me comments by U.S. mail, whatever works, by fax.
So, Ariel, you think we have definitely one more, we have a need, or really we want one more for land use. You're
definitely
saying we actually might have one more.
To look at the land use maps, yeah. But we could also have a workshop just to discuss the policies, and it would have to be, you know, just kind of, we couldn't go through it section by section because we just totally run out of time, you know. But it could be just an opportunity for people to get together in an open forum to have the opportunity to just actually talk about that all in one room, you know.
Well,
but what do you guys think?
I think it'd be a good idea. It puts a little burden on us to do homework, a good bit of homework, and also a burden on you because you might get comments from different people that conflict with each other. And if that's the case, we need to hash it out in
right.
form.
So that, yeah, uh-huh.
So okay. it needs some time for us to get the comments to you, you to sift through it, make changes, and then bring back to this group, you know, a few items that are in conflict. Here's the input I've gotten. We need
mm-hmm.
to decide which way we're going to go.
Right, right. Depending on the feedback,
on the feedback that you get. And you may get a bunch of conflicts, you might not.
Or, yeah, I might not get anything. So, how soon do you think we should aim for our policies workshop then?
Matt, you told me you had a problem with the 2nd.
May 2nd, I have a conflict.
So that moves us to the 9th.
May 9th?
Uh-huh. So you would want to do 2 policies first, and then land use map, review land use map?
Yeah, and we were thinking, we were thinking late May, early June for the land use maps workshop, because in between we want to develop the work programs, which is generally just done in individual meetings with local governments.
Right.
On these policies, if it's a new issue that wasn't around last time you did the comprehensive plan, where did the policies come from?
Well, the policies came out of the old comp plan and the common community vision. Luckily, for every issue that came up, I was able to find policies that that fit.
Okay.
So,
yeah, a lot of these same topics and needs and things were thought of 10 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. It's, yeah, they've been ongoing.
Are you
going to
send the land use?
The land use maps? Yes.
So when is that meeting?
Oh, our next workshop, right.
The one after, so we meet again on the 9th.
May 9th?
If we 2 weeks beyond that is Memorial Day weekend.
Oh, yeah.
So I would recommend at least going a week beyond that.
So May 9th, which is Monday, yeah.
Monday the 9th.
May is Memorial Day.
Right.
Right. So the first Monday in June.
Yeah.
Good.
Oh, first Monday in June for the land use workshops. Okay, so policies on May 9th and the land use on, let's get the calendar
here.
Yeah. Great. June 6th, did you say?
That is, I believe it's June 6th.
Okay.
I know June 3rd is that Friday.
Okay. yeah, Monday, June 6th.
For land use part, we would be looking at not only the future development map, but also character areas and their definitions.
Yeah.
The opportunities here to revisit all of that. I don't know how much we wanted to jump into that swamp.
Right, that's could be quite a swamp. But yes, DCA requires existing land use maps and, or I think maybe they only require. They definitely require future land use or character, character areas, which
well,
is the same thing.
Yeah, the land use element is optional, if I remember right. But we opted to do it. So if we do, we got to do it according to their standards.
And I think we should.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Okay.
Are we talking about having these meetings at 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock?
What does everyone prefer?
Five
works fine because neither of those dates conflict with planning commission meetings.
Yep. That's the only thing we've got to look out for is that.
Yeah.
So I mean, to me, I don't mind going at 5 either one of those days.
So May 9th, 5 p.m. and June 6th, 5 p.m. And
Here?
Sure.
I'm good with meeting here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we'll schedule both ones for meeting at SGRC. Okay, so May 9th, how many days does that give me? All right, I'm going to
get 3 weeks.
Right, I'm going to get tonight's results into the issues section and into the policies section with policies associated with the issues and get that out by email absolutely as soon as I can, and it'll be on the website. So I should be able to do that in a couple of days. And guess that's it.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Is the meeting adjourned?
Yes, you are free to go. Go feel free to stay in chat.
Thank you.
Thank you.